Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Simi Mehta, and I am the CEO and Editorial Director of IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav Evam Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nai Delhi. And I heartily welcome all of you to the panel discussion on rural realities for the state of Goa, practitioners' experiences in tackling the second wave in Indian villages. This program is being organized by the Center for Habitat, Urban and Regional Studies at IMPRI. So I hope all of you, your loved ones, and everyone around you are staying safe and you are healthy. As the second wave of the COVID-19 rages across the country and engulfs the rural spaces this time as compared to the first wave, since the start of this month of May, IMPRI has been organizing state-wise discussions to understand the practitioners' perspectives on the grassroots realities, to get a grasp of the existing situation in the hinterlands. So far, we have held discussions for all the states of India, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Haryana, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, West Bengal, Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura, Manipur, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Sikkim, Odisha, and now we are here to discuss the state of Goa. And we are so delighted that we have an excellent panel of practitioners from the state of Goa to deliberate on this very important issue. So I just take a moment to introduce to you our expert panelists. The moderator for the session is Dr. Albertina Almeida. She is the member of Asia Pacific Forum on Women, Law and Development, and she's a lawyer and a human rights activist from the state of Goa. Our panelists are Madam Maria Aurora Cotto. She's an Indian writer, educationalist from Goa. We have with us Mr. Kumar Kalanand Mani sir. He is the president of the Peaceful Society Goa. And we have with us Ms. Sabina Martins. She is the founder of Bailancho Saad, a women's collective. She's also the managing trustee of Saad Alashiro, a trust of the Bailancho Saad. And she is the convener of Goa Bachao Abhiyan, an activist and a panel member of Taluka Lok Adalat Goa. So thank you so much, and I welcome all our esteemed panelists for today. And we have with us our presentation team led by Mahima, Ms. Mahima and Ms. Swati. And thank you so much. I welcome you all again. And I hand it over to Albertina ma'am to take the discussion forward. Albertina ma'am, over to you.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
So as I understand, you will make the presentation before we proceed to start the discussion, right?
Yes, ma'am. You could make your initial remarks and then you could invite the presentation team.
Ma'am, if we can have your opening remarks first to set the context, then we present.
Okay.
Yes.
Welcome to everyone to in this panel discussion. We are talking about the rural experiences. And as I understand, the rural is not also a monolith as much as in Goa as in anywhere else. So rural means the rural rich, the rural poor, the rural disabled, the rural women as against other genders. So there are different sections that are impacted differently. And I would like to locate this discussion also in the context of a situation which otherwise prevails and which is accentuated by COVID-19 in terms of policies and programs. So so this is something I'd like to state at the very start. The other thing I thought that's very important to look at is in terms of how is the government responding to COVID-19, but also as a consequence, what are our experiences, but as a consequence of this, what is also the impact on health, dealing with health issues in terms of other, other illnesses, which in fact because of the lack of appropriate redressal available for dealing with other kinds of issues, other kinds of health concerns, it leads up to comorbidities. So this is another area that one needs to look at. And the third area, I think, which I'm assuming that this is also applicable in the rest of India, is that under the cover of COVID-19, there's a lot of projects being sanctioned, macro projects, etc., being sanctioned, a lot of suppression of freedom of speech, etc., that happens in the name of COVID-19, in the name of redressing COVID-19. So, and in the garb of these, curfews, lockdowns, whatever they may be styled as. So these are very differential impacts that are there as on account of one, on account of how COVID-19 is addressed, the experiences, COVID-19 per se. The other is the other linked implications for the population in Goa. Here, one also will see that the issues are wide ranging from lack of access, first of all, for a rural person, lack of access to even basic information. There have been sometimes, as compared to the first wave, now they have had some kind of advertising, or at least that's happened in some of our villages, at least, that a vehicle has gone around, talking about, the testing, the vaccination, etc. But there's been very little information about COVID per se to people. And even the facilities that are available, the manner in which it is organized leaves much to be desired. People are scared to even go to a testing facility now because they're afraid that if they're suspected to be COVID, they would be, they might end up getting COVID even if they didn't have it, being queued in those lines for hours together, and with not even being able to maintain the kind of distance because of the large queue, or having to stay there endlessly and falling more ill in the process. There have been issues about availability of medicines. There have been issues of the medicines prescribed. There are also restrictions on which hospitals can prescribe those medicines. There have been issues about the availability. Everybody knows about the whole issue of availability of oxygen. Then besides this, there are the issues of accessing various other related facilities like food, etc. There have been peculiar situations also here in Goa, in the sense that there have been times when civil society has risen up to the occasion and said, okay, we will provide the oxygen cylinders, and the government, there have been times when the government has said, no, we will not take external oxygen cylinders from you. So there have been these kinds of occasions. It's like a dog in a manger approach, where neither you provide nor let civil society provide. But there have sometimes it has reached such a situation that they've had no option but to allow civil society to help out. And civil society has really risen to the occasion. But the situation is pretty alarming. Even at this point of time, the ratios are the positivity rate is at around 30%, which is very high for in terms of percentage. And also considering that Goa's population is very is a small population, Goa is a small state, this should ring very serious alarm bells even now, when it has slightly reduced in the last 1 week. To add to this is also the other issues about what happens to post-COVID, treatment, or in those terms, that what are the implications for the people who have gone through this treatment? There have been reports of many people falling ill afterwards and passing away afterwards as well, even after they were discharged and supposedly well. So there is a range of issues, but at the heart of it is the whole question of access to healthcare, access to health infrastructure, especially for the more disadvantaged sections of society, but generally for everybody, but more specifically very acutely for the more disadvantaged sections of society. very serious concerns, even in terms of like people who fell ill. There weren't the COVID care centers. So like at the first, during the first wave, they had established some COVID care centers and they had quickly dismantled. This is the other issue. They quickly dismantled whatever infrastructure had been kind of reorganized for COVID. They quickly dismantled it, thinking that it's not necessary, but not planning ahead. And in this whole process, they have let the whole thing scale up. Another peculiar issue about Goa is because of its smallness and also because of its tourist state, there has been quite a constant demand that we should be particular about people coming in across the borders into Goa, because there's so much that we can do with our infrastructure and with the smallness of our state. But especially when it comes to tourism and the whole disregard that tourists tend to have because they're in another place and they needn't bother kind of attitude. But the government has not paid heed and has posited it as an issue of economy versus lockdown kind of issue. Whereas actually this is not an either or situation. I think we could have very effectively dealt with our economy as well as the issue of treatment for COVID-19. And if through judicious use of finances, which is another issue that we need to look at, because there are no dearth of avenues for revenue generation, which the state has failed to generate. And in terms of the money that it does have, what are the priorities in where it is being spent, so that in the end, there is money for COVID treatment as well as there is money for all the other amenities that citizens require in their ordinary day-to-day life. Because the rest of the world and the rest of life doesn't come to a standstill. All the other issues and demands and realities still remain. So having said that, I will now throw throw the virtual space open for a discussion. But before that, before the discussion, we will have a little presentation by the IMPRI team on Goa in terms of a little presentation that they have done. They have been doing these presentations for various states, and this is a presentation now that they have done about Goa.
Right, thank you.
So I invite the.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. And so our team has prepared a slide for the numbers, quantitative things, and Swati and Mahima will present. Swati, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
It will just give an idea in terms of number of cases, fatalities, vaccination and all, so that we have an enriching discussion. So with that, Mahima, over to you.
Devabori sans Dev. Good afternoon. I'm Mahima Kapoor, researcher at IMPRI. Presently, I'm pursuing my bachelor's in economics at Miranda House College, University of Delhi. With this presentation, I'll be giving an insight into the state of Goa with respect to the COVID-19 pandemic. Goa is a state on the southwestern coast of India within the region known as the Konkan. It shares borders with the states of Maharashtra and Karnataka, with the Arabian Sea forming its western coast. It is India's smallest state by area and fourth smallest by population, which is 14.59 lakhs according to the 2011 census. This population is divided across two districts, North and South Goa. North Goa is further divided into three subdivisions, Panjim, Mapuka, and Picholim, and South Goa into five subdivisions, Ponda, Marmagao or Vasco da Gama, Madgao, Kupam, and Dharbandora. The official language of the state is Konkani. Goa is visited by large numbers of international and domestic tourists each year because of its white sand beaches, places of worship, rich flora and fauna, and mesmerizing architecture. This architecture has had influence of the Portuguese, who in the 16th century colonized Goa until its annexation in 1961. Morjim, Bagator, Kalangut, Arjuna, Agonda, and Palolem are a few major beaches. The land is rich in mineral and ores, making mining a prominent industry. Declining forest cover and health hazard to the local population caused the court to stop iron ore mining 3 years ago. Looking at the socioeconomic indicators, we see that the state leads in terms of the standard of living. It ranks first in terms of per capita income and seventh in sustainable development goals among the states of India. Measures of sex ratio and literacy rate are superior to the national averages as well. The state houses 38% of its population in the rural areas, roughly half of that in India as a whole. Goa is expected to witness the most severe slowdown in its economy, owing to the heavy dependence on the tourism industry. The hospitality and the entertainment industries have been hard hit due to the general decline in footfall and caution of the tourists. In the first wave of the pandemic, the state was relatively well placed. The new cases accelerated to hit the peak at 740 on 12th September 2020. Within a period of just 1 month, the positivity rate had increased from 0.24% to 3.6%. The recovery rate was 74.2% and the fatality rate 1.1%. In the second wave, however, the number of new cases have been about four times higher than the first wave. The recovery ratio deteriorated to 72.24%, one of the country's poorest, and the fatality ratio to 1.7%. The positivity rate has dropped from 42.8% in the first week of May to 31%, although it still remains a cause of concern, according to experts. In North Goa, Bicholim, Siolim, Sakhali, and Chimbel have been the worst hit, while in South Goa, it has been Kansolim, Vasco, and Karcharam. A major proportion of this problem can be attributed to the lax lockdown restrictions, keeping in mind the state's tourism status. The curfew has been extended till 31st of May. So far, about 33% of the population has received the first dose, and only 6.5% have been fully vaccinated. Out of this, 27% of the jabs have been administered in private facilities. Goa is one of the three states with less than 1% of wastage in vaccine doses. The state government has said that it currently has only 6,000 vaccine doses for the age group of 18 to 44 years and has asked for permission to reallocate doses from 35 age group and above. Furthermore, they are planning to open on-the-spot registrations. There is a pertinent set of emerging issues in the state. The death of 75 patients at Goa Medical College and Hospital due to dropping oxygen levels made the headlines recently. The government has taken over the rights to admission in all 21 private hospitals in the state treating COVID-19 patients from May 17th to ease the load on such facilities. They have pushed for an increase in oxygen quota as well. Assent has been given to use ivermectin tablets to all above 18 years in order to reduce mortality, even when WHO has advised against it. Various stakeholders are working towards reviving the tourism sector, thereby rejuvenating employment and the economy. With this, we wish and pray for the safety and health for the state of Goa. Dev Bore Karum. Thank you.
Devore Koru to you too. And thank you for that presentation where you have highlighted some key concerns along with the data that you've presented. I would now, as I said, throw the virtual space open for discussion. And I would begin by inviting Dr. Aurora Kuto to share her thoughts on what are the experiences at this time. Each panelist has about 8 minutes.
Well, I need much less than that. Thank you, Albertina. I think Albertina has covered almost every department of our life and the life of the state, or I should say the tragic conditions in which we are trapped. And it's something that a state like ours, which is supposed to have been a model state, should never have had to endure in the first place. Both Sabina and Albertina are active in so many different parts of social work and things concerned with women's, the life, improvement on the lives of women and the improvements of life society in general. So they have a very detailed picture of what is going on. I'm a very retired human being, but I do live in a village. And so perhaps I should start with the good news first, which is that our public, and I mentioned this is as our public health center, that means the public health center of Aldona, which covers, I think, 8 or more villages which constitute our constituency, perhaps there are more than 8 villages, has been very efficient. They have been very good with testing. They have been very good with vaccination of age groups which are currently permissible. And they've also been very good with supervision of home treatment. But after that, beyond that, I think it is a slide into chaos, corruption, and ignorance. The lockdown, shutdown, curfew has not been practiced seriously at all. It has not been enforced either by the police or by supervision by the panchayat. And I think that my focus here is really that the panchayat, the officials of the panchayat, Zila Parishad, all these local bodies have to be much more active if any of these regulations are to be followed. I rarely see masks being worn above the chin. Nobody seems to think that masks are important. They buy them, they hang them around their necks, but they are not worn. Vegetable markets, the vendors actually wear them, but not the people who come to buy the vegetables. So this kind of supervision to see that rules are enforced is very, very important. Today morning, for instance, I have a team of gardeners that comes once a month to help me look after my garden. I looked out the window and two of the chaps had their masks below the chin. So I don't think they even understand the need. I'm not underplaying the intelligence of these people, of my fellow villagers. They're all extremely intelligent, extremely good at their professions. But the need for this kind of care has not really been understood sufficiently. So, and then as Albertina pointed out, the airports were thrown open for everybody to come in without any vaccination, without any testing, without any anything. The interstate borders too, I don't think have been looked at. So cars, I know that in my village alone, not so much now after the second lockdown, but in the earlier lockdown, the cars that passed our roads were number plates from all over the place, but certainly not only Goa. So local, my insistence is on local bodies, on panchayats, and that they should be involved in the maintenance of protocols. They should interact with the villagers, going house to house to explain the imperative of proper wearing of masks, of being vaccinated, the need for vaccination, the need for social distancing. I've had people coming here, peeping into my window because I sit, my desk is near the window. So it is a very difficult situation here, but I think people do not do what they are expected to do because they do not understand the need. And also, it's important immediately to start producing or enabling vaccination for the under 45s, because now first they said it can be done and now they say there are no vaccines. So the confusion about vaccines availability and age groups has added to misinformation. Today my helper said, "Madam, in this hospital if you pay 2,000 you get it," and I said, "No, that's not true." She said, "No, it is true." Now, how do you find out whether this information from a village by a villager is true or not? Where did she get this information? Why is this information being made public? I mean, not public, being talked about in some groups. So active supervision by local bodies and police is essential if we are to cope with the third wave. The tragedy that has struck our beautiful state and a happy people is something that is just too tragic for words. I don't think I can say much more than that. Have I disappeared?
No, you're present.
Did you hear my bhashan?
Yeah, yes, ma'am, we did.
So yes. That's what I wanted to say, that, you know, for me, it's a huge tragedy. It's a beautiful state. The politicians are fighting amongst themselves. It looks as though they couldn't care a damn about it. So thank you, Albertina. If there are any questions about Aldona, I'm happy to answer.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Kuto. I think you've highlighted the importance of the role of local elected bodies. And also, while you were talking about the positives, I want to say that, really speaking, the medical fraternity and all the medical health workers have all been really active. And there's really nothing to, there's been no grievance about them. This is not, perhaps not only with the case with Aldona, but the case with all over Goa, and also the Goa Medical College, the state health, the state hospital, as well as the district hospitals. I think they have been working round the clock, really hard, and that's something positive. But the question has been about the circumstances under which they are compelled to work, and the situations that could have been much lighter on them also, if the enabling infrastructure and enabling decision making powers and were there. One of the issues that was also highlighted was about the availability of the lead people in the state hospital, how they're holding different posts at the same time, which is not conducive to effective administration of a hospital, especially more so during a pandemic. And that's something I think we also need to bear in mind in terms of policy approaches. We will now move on to Mr. Kalanan Mani. He's been a long time traveler in the journeys for social justice and development justice. And I invite you, Mr. Mani, to share your thoughts and concerns on the way the pandemic, the second wave, is being handled.
Please, sir, please unmute yourself kindly. Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you, Albertina. I'm really sorry for joining quite late. You can see the plight of people who are trying to be linked through digital means. Even the digital system in Goa is really very bad compared to maybe other states. So we can see that how the young generations are coping, struggling since last 14 months of lockdown. Through the digital means. It took me nearly 20 minutes to join you all. It's very sad, very painful to see that a beautiful Goa, not in terms of the nature, but in terms of community, in terms of society, people, and in terms of governance also, is ruined. When I see the entire course of 14 months of imprisonment of Goa and Goan and those who are in Goa in the name of COVID management. For last 14 months, I have not seen any government officials or government people approaching the people or approaching any organization for their help or for their awareness about how to get out of this COVID-19. So when I see the governance or the management of COVID, I see total absence. What is happening in the hospital is the one scenario, but what is happening in the grassroots is completely different scenario. The first phase of COVID had very little impact on Goa, but the second phase is spreading like a fire. You know, I mostly spend my time in a village area Madkai and Kundai. And I see that, you know, there is a very serious community spread of COVID, and nothing is happening from the government side, except if someone goes to the PHC for the test, he or she get few medicines and are advised to be isolated at home. Well, who can be isolated? Only you can say those have a big house, having multiple rooms with attached bathrooms and toilets, can afford to be isolated. But look about the, you know, the common people, the Bahujan Samaj, and having a small house, one or two house are sharing same toilets. They for them, you know, the advice about isolation is a basically advice about suicide, and there is no follow-up, and absolutely no follow-up. I remember about the governance of the health department in 80s. You know, I will share you my own example. When I my marriage registration was taking place, I was asked to give a malaria free certificate, and I had to go to PHC in Fonda. I have to give my blood test, and my marriage was registered only after having a negative test about the malaria. So the in 80s, 90s, 2000, or we can say that beginning of 2000, the health system in Goa was at par with any state in this country. But what we find that as the governance has collapsed in many sectors, we see total absence of the governance as far as the COVID-19 is concerned. And it has become really very serious when we are witnessing the widespread community spread of COVID-19 for last 10, 15 days. Government might be showing different mortality rate or mortality data, but when we see the plight in the rural areas where the families are helpless, really they don't have access of even food also, you know, which I'm seeing last 1 week. Because of lockdown, they cannot go out. They have no market near around. At 2-3 members in each families are positive. They are facing social stigma to move out. Shops are closed, no supply in the shops. And there is no system from the government to help out of those poor who are isolated at home. So it's a really very, very grim situation. One should not take only death into account. One should also see that how the poor communities are facing hard time, even during the second phase, where they have no community support, no panchayat support, no health support, no government support, and we don't know. And even we don't have access of access to move so freely. Because there is a lot of fear whether I am the carrier of this virus. So we do, at least I as an activist do not know how to really make a very consolidated intervention to address this the very crucial situation. So scenario at the village level is extremely bad, extremely bad. What I was reading or listening about UP or Bihar or Bengal or Madhya Pradesh or Rajasthan, that is happening much more now in the rural area of Goa. That the scenario is. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mani. I think you've raised some very major concerns about, especially about the access, the digital access, which is so necessary, and the poor state of the digital infrastructure and the connectivity, et cetera, in Goa, which also impinges and has a bearing on issues of education, especially for school children, because schools have been closed down now for this whole academic year, schools, colleges, educational institutions, and they've been online And one can just imagine, as Mr. Mani rightly said, one can just imagine the plight of what it might have been, what it must have been for a whole section of school students in the remote areas where there is no connectivity. And not even sometimes, not even in the remote areas, even in areas like where I stay, for example, which is a semi-rural area in a sense, but it's not remote. And if people like us face connectivity issues, one dare not even imagine this. But I mean, it's something that we need to take further, perhaps when we are talking about the moving forward section in terms of access to health and access to infrastructure. I will now move on to Dr. Sabina Martins. She's also been a long-time traveler in the journey for social justice, a co-traveler, in fact, for human rights, for gender justice, and development justice. Yes. Welcome, Sabina, and I ask you to share your thoughts.
Dr. Albertina, if I may take a moment to introduce ma'am, because when I was introducing, she was not able to connect at that time.
So
welcome, Dr. Sabina Martins. Dr. Martins is the founder of Bailancho Saad and convener of Goa Bachao Abhiyan. So good evening, and over to you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, I missed most of the discussion because the internet is fluctuating, and I don't know when I'll be cut off. And I also really don't know whether I will be repeating the points made by the other panelists, because since we live and share in the same state, it's same area, and work on similar issues. Now, I'll just highlight some of the issues that we faced in the second wave. Since we work with women, first thing that we found was that there was no information reaching the rural women. And I'm talking about those women who cannot read newspaper, who are not on WhatsApp, or they are digitally connected. So they don't watch news. So whatever information that was coming about the second wave, they were completely unaware. So when the curfew was imposed in Goa, and we were telling women, don't come to the office, they're saying, what curfew, for what, we don't know. So though it was there in the newspapers, on TV news, and WhatsApp messages were going on. So there is a whole section of vulnerable members of society who are not connected, and information doesn't reach them. Second point that I wanted to make was that when these women fell ill, or family members fell ill, they could not access health care. Now, because of transport, now the testing centers were not close to their house, and they needed to take public transport. So here we also found that people who were positive traveled in public transport to go to the public health centers to get tested. And after they were tested, some of them came positive. So here we could see the risk factor that this transport was never taken into account for these sections of society, because those who are in the urban area, those who have scooters, and could still take their family members to the testing center. But there are a full section of society who don't have access. Yes, someone is asking a question.
Oh,
now, the third thing that
is there some issue of audibility?
Internet connection is really bad for her. That's what she said over the phone. Arjun, if you could connect over phone, and then maybe ma'am can continue.
Yes, I have just called her.
Yeah, the third point she can begin with.
till she connects, can we sort of keep speaking?
Yes, ma'am. May you please take the proceeding further?
Yeah, and let me know when she's
back.
Yeah. So what I also wanted to say is something along the lines of what Dr. Kuto highlighted, that the about the quarrels that are taking place also at the political level. But I just struck me that there's another dimension here, that this is an epidemic and it's being dealt with under the National Disaster Management, under the State Disaster Management Authority. And so you have the bureaucracy at one level, and you also have the health infrastructure at another level. And there seems to be no appropriate coordination between the two, and the tendency also to kind of, dump the blame across on between them. So there is no very clearly defined, there doesn't seem to be a very clearly defined flow chart in terms of, where the responsibilities of one end and the other begin, or how they would coordinate in various kinds of scenarios. There may be, just now they have appointed nodal officers in each hospital, etc., for people to know where bed, in which hospital beds are available, but there isn't the kind of infrastructure and the kind of coordination that there needs to be between the various authorities. So, they're talking about 50% presence of government employees, which really is meant to be ensuring maybe what is called what they call social distance, which now who says that should be called physical distancing. Well, if they can have that implementation of the physical distancing there in the offices, but these very government employees who also get very good salaries should be could be deployed to do other tasks in other places, so that the issue of physical distancing in the office is also handled, and they are doing their responsibilities in terms, because after all of us at the end of the day are working in some way or the other. So I think that's another important thing that we need to look at, and also once again to flag about the budgetary allocations and the budgetary priorities, because there has been a lot of discussion already in Goa about where the finances are focused, what is the focus of the finances, like while India talks about the Central Vista project, over here we have a Samadhi for of the late Chief Minister, which gets a priority over the kind of finances that can be allocated for a whole lot of these other projects. We've got a whole lot of crores of rupees to celebrate Goa's the 60th year of what is called Goa's liberation, nobody understands where that money, how that money is prioritized. So these are some of the issues, and I think.
Yes. Albertina ma'am, Sabina ma'am is here on the phone.
Yeah.
Sabina, yes. Would you like to go ahead from your third point?
I'll just quickly raise the point. As I said, I don't know where it has been raised before.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
Most of the caregivers in the family are generally women, and we've seen them completely overexhausted. And there were some who themselves got infected, and they had to be in isolation. So there are two levels. So in one instance, we had a lady who was very sick, and nobody was willing to take her to hospital. So she took her to hospital, and then the government hospitals were completely overwhelmed. So they had to shift her to a private hospital. Now this whole movement with the COVID positive patients resulted in the caregivers also getting infected. So that is what we noticed. The other thing was about the vaccine. Now, when we try to tell the women, especially those who are above 45, to get vaccinated, they didn't know where to go. There was no information that was there. And besides, there were the other factor. There were stories that were circulating in the villages that if you take the vaccine, you're going to die. So in some pockets, this was very, very strong, very strong rumor. There were rumors saying that even after you take the vaccine, you die. So why do you need to take the vaccine? So this was what happened as far as the vaccines were concerned. The other aspect was that once you took the first dose of vaccine, you get body ache, fever. So there was panic because now this was not explained to them that you might get these symptoms. You just go to a vaccination center, you take the jab and you come home. You're kept there for half an hour. But subsequently, what will happen was not explained in detail. So there was a lot of anxiety and stress with regards to it. And so we had people calling up to ask, this is happening, that is happening, what is to be done? Now, there was the other section of women like who had TB, who were HIV positive. Now, they had a lot of doubts whether they could take the vaccine or not. Now, for them, what happens? See, general people, they call the doctor, they ask neighbors, they ask this one, the status of the vaccine or what happened. Or they are in conversation. Now, these people, they would not like to share that they are either HIV positive or they are suffering from TB or whatever. So this section of people got isolated, and I don't see any effort being made to reach out to these people. And what happens is most of them take treatments at government hospitals, and now that the government hospitals are so overwhelmed, there is no space for these people. Then when it came to the lockdown, when the curfew, they didn't use the word lockdown, when it came to lockdown, it was announced, yes, they said the grocery would be open or whatever, but the people did not have, as I said, that this particular section didn't have that information, and they were completely, stressed out as, how do I get this? Oh, the shops are all closed, and that the time, they didn't know that the timing was from 7 to the shops will be open. And secondly, people don't have money to stock groceries for a month. Now, in the last wave, we were reaching out to people. Putting in touch these women with our families, not necessarily women, but since our contact point was women, with organizations who could provide the ration or whatever. Now, this time down, what happened was, last time there were lots of organizations who were around who were helping out with ration and say for even for the migrant people, whatever. This time down, that help was not there. And women who are, say, we have people who are doing, who are tailors, women tailors. Now, for this whole period, they have no business, so they have no money. You have small people who are selling small things, like say, one lady does shoe repair, so they cannot sit on the streets and do their mending of shoes. Like that, these small entrepreneurs who are there, they are completely marginalized, and they really don't have food. Now, when we were trying to tell them that this month there is rice which is coming free for 2 months, some of them didn't know. So, as I said again and again, I'm trying to say that there has been an information gap. Information is not reaching certain sections. Now, talking about rural people, the factories remained open. So we had a lot of people from the factories moving, working. And there also, now last time when the infection took place, there would be containment zone or there would be sanitizing, and the place would close down for some time till things were sorted out. Now, this time round, it didn't happen. In fact, this time the infection, the people who were positive, COVID-19 tested, who tested positive were a large number. So you had like 7-8 people. In some factories, it was like 20 people. And there was this whole anxiety because they had to work. work. Those people who are not positive, they still had to work, but they didn't know they were positive, because you can be asymptomatic. You're going back to your families, and this a lot of stress was there. Now in the working section, another thing that happened was all those who were daily wage workers, contract workers, they did not get leave if they were positive, but the permanent workers got they got leave, or they were sent for treatment or whatever. So here also there was this in terms of wages, in terms of their workers' rights, you could see a discrimination that was happening. Then we saw in case of caregivers, like now a lot of these home care workers, now in COVID times, the patient needs to be looked after. Now there is institutional care, and there is like at an individual level, patients are keeping caregivers. Now what happens is, okay, at an individual level, if they are saying they are demanding their own price, but those who have joined from the institution, especially the private, there is no record. They are paid so measly. Like I know of a case where they paid 5,000 rupees, and you have to work from 9 to 6 and per month. So there is no monitoring, and I feel there is this whole exploitation which is taking place as far as wages and of workers are concerned. Then in terms of the infrastructure, now infrastructure, medical infrastructure, we didn't see this last time around, but this time we saw the request for oxygen cylinders, that whether you can arrange for a bed, can you give me some doctor's numbers, because doctors are not available. And what happened was many health lines which were put up, as which were circulating, you can call this number, that number, half of them were non-functional. So there needed to be something which was really kind of a helpline which could be definite. And even if there are no beds and no oxygen or whatever, the people need to be told, okay, this is not available. But instead of, just spending a lot of time calling up, sending WhatsApp messages, waiting. So this time round, we saw that. Now, what we found is that the community support structure worked. Like, so if a family got infected, the family members were helping, although they were not coming into the house. Okay, outside the food would be kept, or but when it came to washing, collection of garbage, all that, those issues remained. But at least the food and the medicine, the family supported, and sometimes friends, community did. So at one level we saw that, but at the same time we also saw these families who got COVID being discriminated. Even people who had became negative also were they were kept afar, and there was discrimination. Another thing that happened was the beds and all were available. Now say you are living in North Goa district, and the bed is available in South Goa, or you are told to go to Ponda, which is another place far off. So these distances made it difficult for patients to be there. Well, of course the patient would be there, but those who the family members who were taking taking responsibility, they had issues. So then we had people who were vulnerable, who lived in rented rooms. They had no place for isolation. Now, and they happened to be the migrant community, or people who lived like in the huts, or sometimes they lived in one room, and there are like so many, 7-8 people living. Now, these people, they were sent to isolation centers. So one experience was, see what happens, there is this viral load, there is mild, moderate, severe. So we saw people getting into these isolation centers, and then they said, no, now you go, because somebody else has a higher viral load, so you will get further, you'll get sick further. So there was this kind of confusion which was there, and some of them were, like this happened last time, also that they were sent back immediately. So we don't know now, these are all medical issues of how long people should be kept, and if there are other people with a higher viral load, whether these people should be kept together or not. Now, these are medical issues which I feel needed to be sorted out. The common person, cannot make sense out of it and question them why I'm being sent when I'm still not, negative and things like that. Then, there were single women and all who wanted to be admitted because there was nobody to take care. They were so frightened to stay alone and they said nobody around us, so they didn't get things. Now, when it comes to policies, the government in the second wave took it very, very lightly. So as they've already mentioned that we've had a lot of gatherings, social gatherings, political gatherings, there were elections. Then there was this, fair which had taken place. There was the carnival which took place, and you know, the casinos were open. Now, all just in the name of economic activity, and we have put the entire population at risk. So, the other thing, as far as is my time up?
No, ma'am, please go on.
Education is concerned. This last I'll mention about.
Yes, last 1 minute, Albertina.
Pardon?
Yes. Ma'am, last 1 minute, if you can wrap your last point, please.
Last one about education, especially. Now, in terms of teachers were called to school to do online teaching. Okay, now teachers were at risk. Now, online could have been done from home. So, but it varied from institutions. Somebody has already mentioned that the students, especially coming from rural sectors, that is, I know a lot of students who came to us, they didn't have mobile, so, and they were not getting information. And so their education has gone completely for a toss. And so this is something. And just the last point is the domestic violence increase. In fact, the first day of curfew, I got calls saying that I've been beaten up, thrown out of the house. What do I do? I have no transport to go to the police station. So we just had to give, the helpline of the police. But the response was not satisfactory. So this is another thing which we have found in response to crimes against women. Because of this whole digital, you send a WhatsApp or you call, that you will help will reach you doesn't happen all the time. And so the things are quite, stressful for women who are facing domestic violence, even children. So there is also violence against children which is happening, and we've had cases of children also. I think I'll stop here. We can add on as the discussion proceeds.
Sure. Thank you, Sabina. I think what we will do within the remaining time is we could maybe have a discussion on have some kind of a throw up our views on the way forward and have a discussion around it maybe. What do you suggest, Dr. Kumar, given that we have about 26 minutes?
Albertina, may I have 2 minutes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am,
sure.
Or we can go to each panelist one by one. And Albertina, ma'am, if you have any specific question or you want to have any specific thing from any panelist.
May I have 2 minutes?
Okay. Manish, sir, please.
Thank you. You see, there is no much reflection about the situation of the farming community. And in Goa, mostly the families of Bahujan Samaj, common poor families are involved in that. They are mostly tenants. The last in 2020, the lockdown was imposed at the end of March, and that is the time when people starts harvesting cashew, which goes on till the beginning of monsoon. So even in 2020, they were not able to harvest much of cashew they were not able to make much of hurrak out of cashew. Even the mango plucking and mango marketing also affected a lot. And I know that a good number of people among the Bahujan Samaj, you know, they depend on plucking and the selling of mango in between April and May. This is just 2 months or maximum 2.5 months. So even last year, they missed out the season in 2020. And unfortunately, they have also missed out in 2021. Similarly, about the coconut, you see, the May or beginning of June is the time to pluck the coconut. And thereafter, we have monsoon. Even last year, they missed out. They missed out in the whole monsoon because the labor force were out. Not only industry in Goa or construction in Goa is depending on migrant labor, but even in the farming sector, the lot of migrant laborers are contributing for last few years. So because of the absence of the farm laborers, they were not able even able to make use of the coconut. If I have to say my own experience, we were able to pluck only once out of 4 times. And this time again, you know, we don't see that we would be able to pluck coconut again. Same thing with the kokum. Kokum is also a cash crop, a kind of which gives a subsidiary income to many families. And like last year, even this year, they won't be. So in a nutshell, the Goa horticulture sector is badly affected, and which is impacting the life of the rural poor. Similarly, about you see, when we discuss about the lockdown or etc., one must also think about how the rural poor are going to manage their life, whether it's in terms of economy, in terms of food, or in terms of treatment. Therefore, more focus today, what I see in the name of COVID-19, even second phase, is basically about the hospitalization or oxygen or treatment, etc. But there is still no focus about how it is impacting, spreading, in the large rural areas, and basically which sectors are more impacted. Even if we see the housing pattern, I can tell you about the housing pattern basically in Kundai and Madkai industrial areas, where about 15 years before, people had a reasonably bigger house. But since the number of industrial laborers started staying in around, they converted their house into small rooms, and many Goans, you know, compelled themselves to live in a small house. And today we see that, you know, in the name of isolation, they are not even able to manage themselves well. So altogether, situation is becoming very grim, and I don't know whether it will go out of hand. And I don't see any package, any program, any relief for the rural poor, for the small farmers, and for all those who were surviving, even in Goa, who were surviving. I'm talking about the Goan community. I'm not talking about the migrant only, but I'm talking about the Goan labor who were surviving on daily wages. And losing of daily wages, especially these time, is a big loss for them. So when we're thinking about the way forward, I think we should also take into account of this section of rural society. Thank you.
Who would like to go next?
Sabina ma'am is here. Maria ma'am
will join some connectivity. Okay. Sabina ma'am, can you speak over the Zoom? You can check.
You would want some suggestions for what can be done?
Ma'am, Zoom is working.
Yes.
You can leave the phone.
Yeah, it just keeps going. Now here one is, I think
Arjun, you'll have to bring her back on phone.
Yes. There are really difficult connections.
Mm. student.
Okay, one of the rest of us continue?
Please.
Dr. Kuto, would you like to add something?
Yes. Ma'am Sabina, ma'am is with us. Yeah.
One is as far as for information dissemination, we need some mechanism in place that at a micro level, information has to reach people. One. Two, we need to have, when we talk about hostels,
we need hostels for people who are not infected also. Sometimes if a large, if there are many members who are infected and one or two are negative, then so the family can stay in the house and those one or two individuals can move out or stay. So we need to have accommodation for people who are not infected also, so that when they are doing isolation, the infected people are at one point. The other thing which I wanted is the mechanism to address domestic violence has to be taken up very seriously. There have to be people who should be on the move to be able to reach out. It's not just over the phone, but sometimes physical intervention is required. So that mechanism has to be activated. The other thing is about the reaching food grains reaching out, and also some amount of money should be given to people who, especially during this lockdown, are not able to earn a livelihood. So that some amount monthly should be given to these people. Then as far as the workplace, there has to be monitoring at the workplace, because there is a lot of salary cuts that are taking place, illegal salary cuts that are taking
denial of leave, medical. A lot of these issues are also happening. So the Labor Department
mechanism, maybe under the disaster management, should look into these issues. This is something very, very crucial, because large scale exploitation is taking place. Then as we mentioned about the all the illegal constructions and violations, CRZ, coastal violations that are taking place now, and this is happening because during COVID times the activists are restrained from coming out on large numbers or whatever. So this is just going on with impunity. So somewhere there has to be a mechanism, maybe through the court, because the governments are not doing it, they are allowing it. So under the court supervision, there should be a body to check all these areas where people can report to, so that some action could be taken.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sabina. So I would say there's a lot of issues that have been highlighted, a lot of suggestions also about the way ahead. And if I may also add that for any planning, there has to be a proper data management, so that there can be an analysis of the situation to plan the way forward. Besides getting information and taking the benefit of what others have done who have already been in those situations. But I don't see that happening. There is a very scanty data. In fact, because of for the purposes of this session, I tried to figure out if there was possibility of getting disaggregated data on the basis of urban and rural. I couldn't get anything, and neither is there any data on disaggregated data like gender disaggregated data or anything like that, or in terms of which sections of people are approaching which places, who are at least being tested positive, etc. There's absolutely a dearth. So I think there's a need putting together this data, that the government needs to put together this data. Also, that there have been many, I think there's also a certain level of fatigue that that the communities are reaching in terms of community support, because it's one thing in terms of the state to comply with its obligations, and it's another in terms of the communities to support. Of course, the communities need to be involved. Of course, the communities will be supportive and should support, but there's no substitute for the state's obligation to comply with its responsibilities to the people, and especially to the most marginalized sections of society, be they marginalized on the basis of caste, class, creed, gender, etc. So I think these are some things that we need to flag. Apart from that is the whole question. In fact, I was looking at it. One of the ruling party MLAs itself has said that he was trying to raise this issue in the last assembly, that 40% of the budget should be for healthcare. And this is something, you know, in terms of prioritizing of budget allocation, in terms of budget for healthcare, for education, this is something that we've been talking about all over the, all these years, even in the absence of COVID, and much more so it's necessary in the due to COVID. But perhaps one wonders if at least COVID will make the government sit up and realize that these are the areas where for the well-being of the people of a place in terms of governance, these are the areas where budget allocation needs to be higher. In also the one area I think that that I would like to add on to is the whole area is the like that like Mr. Mani was talking about the farming and agriculture, and those involved in agriculture is also the question. There's also the area of involvement in fishing, the rural coastal communities. There's been a huge impact. There's also been a kind of discrimination vis-a-vis the small fishers as against the larger fishers. We saw that last time. This time also in some ways it's apparent, but maybe not so apparent this time, but there are issues in terms of the facilities. There needed to be an enabling of these communities to earn their livelihood in the face of COVID-19 lockdown, or alternatively to be supported like Sabina said, in terms of some kind of a support for loss of livelihoods because of COVID or because of the restrictions due to COVID. And another whole area that has come up is the whole question of compensation for those who have died because of the government's culpability and negligence, for those who have suffered COVID, not just died, but suffered COVID also because of the culpability and negligence of the state. It's true that the COVID-19 was there anyways, but it wouldn't have reached these proportions. So many states have been able to effectively bring it under control and not have such a high positivity rate. And Goa, being a small state, could have been a model for governance. So I, apart from this, I think some of the important issues that you all have flagged, yes, very, very important, and which Sabina has very, very effectively raised, is the whole question of dissemination of information at the micro level. The second point is about the access to digital infrastructure, access to connectivity, which is both in terms of help for COVID, as well as in terms of other areas of life which are impacted due to COVID, like where it comes to online education, etc. And the government needs to focus on making connectivity available and the infrastructure also, and also in terms of, it's not also the just the general infrastructure, but like the possibility of the families having mobiles with them, because little or nothing has been done on this count. I have to mention here that the Goan diaspora has risen to the occasion. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are. Maria ma'am is also us. So yeah. Whenever you like, ma'am can give a way forward 1-2 minutes.
Yeah, I'll just finish what I was saying. The Goan diaspora has risen to the occasion in terms of providing support. They are looked at as overseas citizens of India and somebody to be despised often in terms of the government's policies, including the Citizenship Amendment Act. But one cannot fail to recognize the the special efforts made by the Goan diaspora to kind of reach out to the various populations in Goa and even to the government facilities. Dr. Kuto, I think you're online again, and I would like you to share your thoughts.
Heartwarming and inspiring. The detailed picture that you and Sabina have given of the terrible conditions in which our people are living and the inability of the government to think positively or think creatively except in ways that serve themselves. And especially this last point you made about home education and connectivity. I mean, we are in Andhra, which is one of the better connected villages, but this doesn't happen. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Please go. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Yes, please speak.
Yes, please go on, ma'am.
Yeah, well, this is the connectivity problem that she was talking about. No, I just want to say that the other panelists have given you a very real and very painful picture of what we are going through and in what is a better state, and it's supposedly a better state, but our political class has failed us miserably. Our doctors, our nurses, our healthcare workers have worked tirelessly, exhausting, and really in inspiring ways. But unless the as I said, the local bodies are also involved, I don't think we can just depend on the politicians, because they will fail us. So we need to also depend on people within our own circle of authority, meaning the local bodies, and try to get them to help wherever help is needed. The point made by the gentleman just now about home treatment, it's quite right. People have very small homes, people have large families which don't have access to this and that. But social workers and village communities have risen to the occasion, but that's not enough. So thank you very much for inviting me. In my limited way, I've tried to say what I experienced from within my home. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Peter. Thank you. Yes, Dr. Albertine, over to you.
I think a lot has been said, and it's quite clear, and I don't know whether I need to repeat that. Just to sort of put it, if I may put it in bullet point, it's like access to information, digital access, let's put it there. Budget allocation, access to basic amenities, access compensation, or a kind of this thing for a kind of a compensation for being displaced from their livelihoods, or especially for the disadvantaged sections of society, special facilities for those who are disadvantaged, such as where they have small housing facilities. And then there are nuanced demands in regard to each of these which have been articulated, and which I don't think I need to repeat because they've been very clearly stated. I'm just putting it out in bullet points. Of course, the other area which has been talked about but which we have not had sufficient time to deliberate on is the whole question of suppression of human rights and carrying on of destruction in the name of development under the cover of lockdowns or curfews. In the first lockdown, it was about various projects. That time itself, a three-prong project which was taking place at Mole. And this time it has been a lot of other projects like field filling, real estate, succumbing to the real estate, the hotel lobbies, etc., which has been going on and people should have been people's concern should have been priority, and there should have been some kind of maintenance of law and order in this regard. And I think another whole area is the whole access to justice, which has been a major casualty. I myself know that as a lawyer, that a lot of people, women who have had their maintenance not paid, etc., or who have put maintenance cases. There are concerns in some courts addressed them and some courts didn't, because they said that that's not a priority. And in the last period when there's been a curfew, even that has not been addressed by anybody at all. And it's not treated as a priority issue, as against, for instance, a high profile rape case where the appeal in the rape case gets such a priority. So, where an appeal has just been filed and on the very next day, it's being heard. These kinds of disparities have also been obvious, and the inequalities also obvious. So I think a lot has been said. I do not know if anybody would, maybe the organizers, I think the organizers would like to say, to add their words of wisdom too.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. You have really clearly said.
Yes.
We are looking at the issue, realities during this COVID-19 time. Now, the point is that there are ongoing issues, and COVID has complicated the process of getting justice. Now, you just see we had the cyclone, and there's a lot of devastation that has taken place. Now, there's a lot of paperwork that needs to be done. So here we are saying social distancing, you can't do this. There's no public transport. People can't get out of their house. The ones who have vehicles on some pretext or the other will go. So so getting justice also for the, especially the vulnerable section, has become very difficult. So whatever issues that are plaguing the state, they are compounded by COVID-19. And the other thing what I want to say is this, yes, we are expecting a third wave. So we also have to be prepared so that whatever issues we are facing now, we should be able to overcome it. I mean, we better prepared to deal with this, because till the COVID goes away, we will be constantly battling it. So one is the disease, the other are the social, political, and economic issues.
True. That's very true. The larger scenario, as is being repeatedly said all over, and I think this is something that is in Goa as well as in all over India, is the question of the accentuation of the inequalities, the accentuation of the malgovernance that has happened during this during the process of the COVID pandemic, and the appropriation of the COVID pandemic.
Ma'am, you just got muted. Ma'am, you're muted.
The appropriation, or rather the use of the COVID pandemic to carry out a whole lot of illegalities. And so therefore, I think this larger picture we always continuously need to be bearing in mind, because otherwise we will be responding more to the immediate situation and not thinking of the larger picture. That's a very important flag. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
To the organizers.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Kumar sir, would you like to add to this, or sir, please unmute.
From my point of view, I would like to divide the whole way forward into three parts. One is the immediate action which is required. One is thereafter, and one is long term. For immediate action, I would say that roughly about 15 to 20% rural population is greatly affected. So first actions would be the mass testing of the COVID cases, number one. Number two, the arrangement for a perfect isolation, which many poor cannot afford. So their families are getting infected very quickly. Third, the food arrangement for the affected families. Fourth, the follow-up with the positive cases, those who are in the rural areas. The follow-up is extremely bad. The fifth, is the post-COVID follow-up with all the people who were affected. So that system has to be built with the panchayat, with the civil societies, and with the hospitals. Fourth, those have lost their livelihood, as earlier speaker have already said, they should be compensated adequately. Fifth, the PDS system should be brought into action at the earliest, at every level, without any much red tape. The health system must be strengthened in order to cope with any kind of pandemic today and tomorrow. And there should be transparency in planning and execution. So these are the points which we should be brought into the whole management of COVID. Goa, being a smallest state, which is blessed with the largest government in the country, this largest government has become liability for the Goan. Largest government is not affected at all, effective at all, in addressing the whole issue of COVID as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mani. I think you've raised this whole very important point about the transparency, which is very important. We still don't have any transparency in so far as the CM's fund, as well as the disaster management fund. There is no data being disclosed about how those funds are being applied. There should have been a suo motu dissemination of that information, at least to start with, on their website. I mean, notwithstanding the fact that is not so accessible, but still at least at that level. And that's, I think, another important point. And the whole coordination between the disaster management authority and the elected bodies and the governance at various levels. Thank you. Over to the organizers.
Sure. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Excellently, you have summed up, and all the panelists. So if we could sum up it just in one word, we need to reprioritize our investments. And then perhaps when this is reprioritized, I think the health of the people will not be at risk again in future. So thank you so much. It was just a wonderful discussion. And with this, we also actually wrap up our state level rural realities practitioners' perspectives for the entire country. And then we will be doing the union territories, though we have started with the union territory of Puducherry. But definitely this session on understanding the Goan rural realities was very, very enriching, illuminating. And I am sure those who are watching us here on Zoom and on Facebook Live and later would be watching on YouTube would know the realities, and then they would it would be upon them and for all of us to understand the situations from the grassroots up. So thank you so much. And I would like to formally propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the Center for Habitat, Urban and Regional Studies, Impli Impact and Policy Research Institute, to Dr. Sabina Martins, to Dr. Maria Arora Kuto, Dr. Kumar Kalanand Mani sir, and most of all, our moderator for the day, Dr. Albertina Almeida. Thank you so much, ma'am. This entire session was really productive, and thank you so much for leading this entire session so effectively. Thank you very much. And I also would like to thank our presentation team, Mahima and Swati and Sakshi and our director, Dr. Arjun Kumar. Yes, ma'am?
Just one correction. I'm not a doctor. I'm illiterate.
Apologies for that, sir. But definitely I came across your work from the grassroots up, from the Bhudan movement, etc. So it is really inspiring. So
thank you.
Congratulations on that. You keep inspiring us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a nice evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Albertina, ma'am. Thank you, Sabina, ma'am. Bye-bye. Thank you. Have a good day. Please be safe. Bye.
Okay, for God.